Hello and welcome to On Point. I'm Melody Soto. More than 60,000 people are estimated to be experiencing homelessness in Los Angeles. According to the LA Homeless Services Authority, or LASA, about 72% of displaced people in the county are unsheltered. But local lawmakers are looking to change this figure by moving more individuals who live on streets into housing. In August, the LA City Council set a goal to construct 25,000 new housing units, both permanent and temporary, by 2025. LA voters have already enacted Proposition HHH, the $1.2 billion measure promised 10,000 housing units, yet slow progress has been made on construction. LA City leaders have also approved a new anti-camping mandate that bans encampments near sensitive areas like schools and prohibits the construction of various public spaces, including freeway underpasses, like here on White Oak Avenue under the 101 freeway, where tents and tarps that line the street were recently removed. According to an interactive map published by UCLA, the ordinance makes 40% of the city inaccessible to homeless people. Critics of the law say that it disenfranchises a large and already vulnerable population. With thousands being relocated, what kind of dwelling options are available to them? Which options are working to make a difference in the city's homelessness crisis? On Point's Alana Martinez has more.
Thank you, Melody. Let's welcome the members of our panel. Ken Kraft, founder and CEO, Hope of the Valley Rescue Mission. Stephen Fichter, senior director of Metro LA Programs, PATH, People Assisting the Homeless of Los Angeles. And Mike Arnold, president and CEO of the Midnight Mission. How are you guys doing today?
Doing well, thanks.
Good to hear. So I want to start off explaining, I've heard different terms for shelter, such as overnight, temporary, short-term, transitional, and long-term. What are the differences of all these various housing options for unhoused people? We'll start with you, Ken.
I look at it as three in particular. There's emergency housing, in which we have an emergency shelter. Okay, that's up in Pacoima, and that's where people can come. It's in a large building. People are sleeping on cots, very little privacy. It's kind of the lowest level. I'm thankful that it exists, but I wouldn't want people staying there very long. And then we have interim housing, which could be in a congregant setting or in a tiny home setting, where people are coming. It's not their permanent house, but they're there. While they're there, they're stabilized. We're able to provide wraparound services to then get them ready for permanent housing when it's available. And then permanent housing is just what it is. It's that place where they're now, they've reached their final, their home. They can, hopefully they have a job, they're working. If not, they're linked to public benefit. And they also, if they need the wraparound service, they get permanent supportive housing as well.
What are the stepping stones to transition to permanent housing?
I know my colleagues here will chime in with my, to fill in the blanks, but typically when someone's experiencing homelessness, we work to engage those people where they are and meet them in their need and build a relationship that will build the trust that's been pretty much destroyed given their situation. And that's very complex, and we can certainly go into that in detail. As those relationships are built, then people trust to move into an interim setting. In those interim settings, there's usually case managers. There might be a more intense case management depending on one of those levels that Ken mentioned earlier. And then as people are connected to those resources, maybe vouchers, maybe ongoing programmatic support, depending on the level of need of that individual, or perhaps they have a mental health challenge or there are physical challenges, or they're simply someone who's lost their home, maybe because of an employment situation and won't need a lot of ongoing support. Whatever supports people need, those are the resources they're connected with. And then as housing is available. And again, that's a big hurdle in Los Angeles to find affordable housing for people. But as those resources are identified, then people are connected to those, get to make a choice on where they want to live, just like the rest of us, we hope. And then they're able to move in, oftentimes with perhaps a rental subsidy for a short period or longer, security deposit and so forth.
I would like to add to that and just say that, you know, the way the question is being asked, there's a new concept out there that's called housing first. And the principle to housing first is that people don't need any intervention to be ready to be in their permanent housing. So, and what that sort of turned into is, I think, a big focus on permanent housing, and we need a lot of permanent housing. But the reality is that in order to have housing first functioning in any kind of a continuum, you need at least two things. You need an inventory of affordable and supportive housing so that people can go into the right environment that's going to keep them sustainably housed. And you need a service infrastructure that's able to provide the services to people to make sure that they address those issues that created their housing instability and keep them from falling out of housing and back in the street. The dilemma we've got here in Los Angeles is we are so under-resourced in any of those interventions that we really end up, to Ken's point, emergency shelter is not designed for long stays, but when you don't have any housing to get people into, emergency shelter becomes a really long stay. Intermediate housing, which is really designed to provide intensive services for a reasonably short period of time, you know, 6 months, 9 months, mostly domestic violence, substance abuse, sometimes mental health and physical health kinds of issues. The whole system has been convoluted because we've got such an acute shortage of any single one of those interventions here in Los Angeles. And we have arguably 67,000 or more people who every single night need one of those interventions to keep them safe and keep a roof over their head. So it's a really complex issue. But the reality is if we had enough housing that we could afford to put people into right now, and we had services to be able to service them in that housing, we wouldn't need any of these other interventions. But we have nowhere near that number of housing.
Are there instances where unhoused people don't want to be housed? And what could those reasons be?
So I'm right in the middle of Skid Row. The Midnight Mission is literally right in the middle of Skid Row, which is arguably, you know, one of the it's the epicenter of homelessness in Los Angeles. It was developed and evolved as a result of a system of containment where if you had someone homeless in your community, the police would bring them down to Skid Row because it would keep them there and out of your communities. But that has led to this huge concentration of people living on the streets. If you've been to Skid Row, you know what I mean. If you haven't been to Skid Row, I would recommend driving through just so you can see, you know, what Skid Row looks like. But on that particular point, what we find are people who have usually long-term episodes of street living. They have engaged with programs multiple times, with programs promising them, come be in my program, stay with me, follow my rules, and then when you leave, we'll make sure you go to housing. And because there's such an acute shortage of housing, people would go in, they would follow all the rules. And, you know, most of our programs, you know, have a fair amount of structure in them designed to help people, you know, rapidly progress with the issues that they're dealing with. And a lot of the programs, particularly those that are government funded, basically say, if you're in an emergency shelter, you should only be there 90 days. So if you can't find someone housing in 90 days, they used to say, okay, you have to leave. I understand you were here, but your 90 days is up and we couldn't find you housing, so goodbye. And I think that has built a lot of distrust of the system. And as a result, there are a lot of folks who say, look, you're not going to get me housing. And frankly, I can stay in my tent and not have to be up at 6, have breakfast at 7, be out of here by 8, and all of these sort of structured program applications that go into the programs. So we do build, I think, a service resistance. There's also a service resistance when people are deep in their addiction, because none of our programs will allow people to use on site. They don't have to be clean and sober to be in our program, but they can't use our facilities as home to drink or to take drugs. They have to do that off-site. So it does create some barriers. So it's a complicated issue. Homeless, there are those who'd like us to believe that homeless is easy, all we need is housing. It's not easy at all, and it's incredibly complicated. And everybody is going to have a very different story. And I think recognizing the individual experiences that everyone out there experiencing homelessness has as their story is really critical to understanding them and achieving engagement with them.
If I could chime in on that as well, to add to the complexity of people, I think the question of choice and how some people perhaps resist responding to what's offered is often used, even weaponized against the community to say, look, you know, we offer these things and people aren't taking them. That resistance may, speaking of complexity, be rooted in the mental health challenge of trauma effects on the brain. It's extraordinarily complex. And I think each individual human being needs to be sort of embraced. And that's why we work, all of us, so hard to build that rapport, to rebuild the trust that's been lost, to work with people and on their individual needs and sort of help understand them. And also to know, and thankfully there are options now in interim and also permanent housing, growing options and not enough for people, because one size simply does not fit everybody.
Mike, you mentioned that people don't have to be, you know, completely sober to go into these facilities. Is there any instances where somebody could be turned away?
If they're under the influence, typically they when they're here in our programs, typically they need to be not a danger to themselves or to others. And various programs, you know, have various different kinds of rules. But as a general rule, particularly here in our facility, we also have a very big substance use disorder program where a lot of folks are struggling to retain their sobriety. So, you know, it makes it a little more difficult. But at the end of the day, we don't turn people away because they have an addiction disorder. But usually they can't be under the influence, or they can't be actively drinking or taking drugs while they're in our facilities, because it's a danger to not only themselves but to other people as well. But we don't turn them away. And in fact, a lot of our folks come in with a substance use disorder. They're not ready to leave their addiction behind, and building that trust that Steve was talking about is really key to helping them see a better future for themselves that they couldn't see while they were out on the streets. So we see a lot of people come to us, and after being with us for a month, they want to actively participate in substance use recovery services. So that whole trust building is really a critical aspect of what we do.
Yeah, and Mike, I would add to that, I know the tiny homes have been interesting because we bring people right off the streets, and they may be even scattered around the area. They're coming in and they might have addiction issues. And, you know, we don't allow, there's no drugs, no alcohol, no weapons allowed on site. Again, people do oftentimes use outside and they come back, but we're really looking for transparency. And I tell people, you know, we're not looking for perfection. We're looking for progress. You know, are you willing to make some progress? Are you willing to be honest? Because ultimately we want people to have jobs. We want them to be reintegrated back into the community. And we have to look at what are the barriers that are preventing them from being housed, from being employed, from being in, you know, back in society. And if a substance use really is that major issue, then we got to deal with it. And so, and I also liken it, though, because sometimes I've been on a lot of community meetings. We've opened up 6 tiny home communities, and people, not in my backyard, this isn't going to work. and, you know, promise me that there's not going to be any drugs or alcohol, promise me. And that's a hard promise to make. And, you know, but I tell people, can you imagine what would happen if anybody that ever got high or ever got drunk in their home, we told them they had to leave their home? Okay, unacceptable. I mean, we would flood the streets with new people being homeless. And yet we expect people who've been traumatized over and over and over again, now come inside, but you better live perfect. It's unrealistic. And so we got to work with people where they're at.
Right. Speaking of tiny homes, permanent housing takes a long time to build. But LA is turning to a new solution to get unsheltered people off the streets more quickly. On Point's Melody Soto has more.
They're popping up across the city, tiny home communities designed as transitional housing. In November, the largest complex in the nation opened in Highland Park. Situated on more than 6 acres, the Arroyo Seco Tiny Home Village can accommodate 234 residents. Organizers say this housing approach is filling a critical need.
The streets should not be the waiting room for those that need housing. Affordable housing takes years to come up. This specific village and all of the other villages have taken 3 months. Each tiny home takes 90 minutes to pop up. And we have found that the longer that people are unhoused, the harder it is to get them housed. They become shelter resistant because of trauma or PTSD. So the urgent thing to do now is to get everybody housed as soon as possible.
The city of LA has built 7 small home communities this year. Hope of the Valley manages daily operations at 6 sites. The Arroyo Seco property features 117 units. Each dwelling measures 8 by 8 feet and is equipped with electricity, air conditioning, and heating. While other shelters separate men from women, this location houses both. It also allows pets.
We also see that the unhoused are kind of like people that are in prison. People forget about them, family and friends, they don't have that. Their pets are, they don't care if they're in a house, so they wouldn't go inside without them. So we feel it's important for us to accept all kinds of pets.
Tiny home units are intended to be occupied for up to 6 months before residents transition into permanent housing. They offer a temporary solution, but Ann Chetta says they won't eradicate homelessness on their own.
We cannot say this is the perfect solution. Anybody that says that would be lying to you, but it's definitely a step in the right direction in getting people off the streets.
At the Arroyo Seco Tiny Home Village, residents receive 3 meals a day, can access supportive services, and they have an address to their name. Reporting from Highland Park, I'm Melody Soto.
So I have a quick question just to clarify. Stephen, maybe you can answer this. Can you explain the difference between Measure H and Proposition HHH?
I'm probably not the best person to make that distinction for you. One of them really was a revenue source for services and support, and the other for the building of permanent housing. And I get them confused, but I think the HHH was for permanent housing. And my colleagues can help me with that.
That's correct.
City and the county try to build complementary kinds of supports. And historically, when we're talking about homeless solutions, the city has always raised their hands and said, you know, housing is really our responsibility. You know, we're the ones that should be providing the housing. The county contracts with many cities, including the city of LA, to provide healthcare services, mental health services. So the county initiative was Measure H, and Measure H provided dollars to provide services to people. And then the city initiative, HHH, created a pool of funds to build somewhere around 10,000 units of permanent supportive housing. And the two of them together was supposed to provide permanently staffed, permanent supportive housing to address a critical need of that particular resource in Los Angeles.
Ken, I'm sure people have seen the tax increase. But the projects are off to a slow start. What do you think the reasons for that is in regards to building permanent housing?
Well, the bond measure was passed in 2016, $1.2 billion to create 10,000 units of affordable housing. Unfortunately, the first complex did not open until January of 2020. And that did not set well with taxpayers who would have expected it to be open quicker. And I think people got very frustrated. And they're thinking, man, our taxes were raised, you know, we voted for this, and we don't see an increase in housing. As a matter of fact, during that four-year period, the homelessness kept increasing double digits every year. So it really was not a good scenario. We passed the bond measure. It takes 4 years to get the first one open. I think it was 68 units. Meanwhile, homelessness keeps increasing 14%, 18%, 16%. And that in part is why the mayor of Los Angeles, Eric Garcetti, declared a shelter emergency. And that shelter emergency changed the landscape for service providers such as Hope of the Valley. Historically, we could only open up shelters in a zoning that was a C2 or CM by right. And we could only have 30 beds or less by right. And when he declared the shelter emergency, that expanded zoning. So now we can be in M1, M2 manufacturing zoning. And that 30 bed cap is gone. That's why, like, the Arroyo Seco has 230 beds. The Alexandria Park has over 200 beds because that cap's lifted. And the third key element to this particular shelter emergency is that the city of Los Angeles can open up a shelter in any zoning as long as, number one, either they own the land, or number two, they're leasing the land. And that's why these first, at least for us, these first six tiny homes, all six of them are on city-owned property. Whether it is Reckon Park site, Metro site, or the city negotiated a deal with Caltrans for one of the other sites, and the other is a parking lot that city owned. And so the city was able to move quickly to get these erected. And like I said in the piece by one of our staff members, it took 90 days from beginning to end to get these sites up. The units themselves go up rather quickly, only within an hour to 90 minutes. And oftentimes, we've had, you know, critics, those who've said, no, that's nothing but a shed. And my response to that is, go talk to the people that live in them. Okay, because the people that live in them say, one guy said to me, as far as I'm concerned, it's the Taj Mahal. Another person said, I live in my own private gated community. And so we know the impact when you treat people with dignity and respect and give them a place to call home, and then knowing that this is not the end. We're working to get them into permanent housing. And like our staff member said, that we believe that permanent housing and supportive housing and affordable housing, that is the end solution. But the streets cannot be the waiting room for permanent housing any more than if I had hypothermia, that you would tell me to wait in the snow until the doctor could see me. That makes no sense. We've got to bring people indoors. We've got to stabilize them. And we have to have a master plan to make sure we address the underlying issues while we're moving them into permanent housing.
I believe your staff member also said that the tiny homes come with actual addresses. So that's a nice touch to it.
Yes, because if you're going to have a job, you need to have mail sent somewhere. And so the mail can be sent, and we make sure that people get their mail.
Do you have any other suggestions that can help the problem with the shortage of supply with the high demand?
I do. I'm actually a really big fan of safe camping. You know, even though the tiny homes, I think, are great interim solutions, they're easy to do. We still, even with all that we've done, we still have tens of thousands of people who are out there and who are unprotected. And the thing that I'm not sure people understand is that while crime may go up in areas that see high homeless, it's usually the people experiencing the homelessness mm-hmm. who are the victims of the crimes. And what we know from working with people who have long-term street histories is it's incredibly traumatic to be on the streets. If you're a woman, you're physically assaulted, you're sexually assaulted, you're beaten up. I mean, the streets are an incredibly dangerous and stressful place for to expect people to live. And we need to rapidly get areas that are safe areas where we can have people have access to basic hygiene supplies, have meals, have medical and social service kinds of activities there. But we've got to get them protected as rapidly as possible. We need safe places where they can set up their tents, and we can do it in a scale that's going to have a huge impact on people who are in the streets. I mean, the only reason people are on the streets is because there's nowhere else that they can go. And we've, you know, unfortunately, Skid Row sees very, very little sort of enforcement around issues. It's a horrible place to live. And I would love nothing more than to have a big city parking lot that we can get people, even with their tents in there, and keep them protected. Make sure that they have basic supplies, basic hygiene. Make sure that nobody's out there hungry. Nobody's cold. Nobody's dying of overdoses, on the sidewalks. I mean, that I think we really need to just move rapidly forward to get something to scale in all of our communities where our most vulnerable have an opportunity to be safe and protected.
And we have seen that model viable in certain locations in Los Angeles, in East Hollywood. In the East Hollywood area, there's a safe camping site that's protected. It has security. It provides food service and hygiene support for people. And it is that low, low barrier for people to move from the dangerous to the safety without, you know, having to step too high into another situation that they're not ready to do.
Does anybody have any last thoughts that you want to add?
I would just throw out, when it comes to the different interventions, I'm agnostic. I don't care whether it's getting people in sanctioned encampments, tiny homes, congregant sites, permanent housing, of course, is the end game, but we've got to get people off the streets. We have to create win-win-win situations, wins for those who are experiencing homelessness, wins for our communities, wins for, you know, people that need the substance, you know, use treatment. We've got to do that. And so sometimes it's darkest before the dawn. And I believe that our best days are in front of us. And I believe if we stay the course, we're going to see a huge change here in Los Angeles.
I want to thank you guys again for coming on here and talking to us and sharing your knowledge about this specific topic.
I hope future conversations can also include BIPOC sisters and brothers and get those variety of voices involved too, because certainly those folks are those experiencing homeless on a much higher percentage than the three white guys. But thank you.
Thank you for watching On Point. We'll be right back. Thank you for watching On Point. You can follow us on social media at CSUN On Point. You can hear us on KCSN 88.5 FM on Sunday mornings at 5:30. And you can watch us on LA 36 in Santa Clarita Valley Television. For all of us here at On Point, I'm Alana Martinez.